Good evening. My name is Francesco Conti and I am an assistant professor of electronics at the University of Bologna in Italy. This evening I'm here to talk about the open flow for deep neural network deployment on ultra-low power RISC-V course for the extreme edge that we developed together with my colleagues at the University of Bologna and at ETH Zurich in Switzerland. First of all, why are we interested in deploying deep neural networks at the extreme edge? The deployment of DNNs in IoT and extreme edge devices is, in fact, can be seen at least as one of the key enabler technologies to advance artificial intelligence applications. If we compare extreme edge execution with cloud-based execution, local AI that uses realistically complex models could result in much better privacy and security than cloud-based AI, improved latency, and much enhanced energy efficiency. Of course, the problem is that we have to have realistically complex models, not tiny toys. However, if we could reach this point, features such as privacy, latency, and efficiency would make many applications such as smart sensors, personal healthcare devices, autonomous nanorobots, and many others much more powerful than they are today. What is the main obstacle that is against developing and deploying deep neural networks in extreme edge devices? The biggest obstacle is the big divide that there is between a set of algorithms that are thought, developed, and trained around the very high performance platforms, such as GPUs or big GPUs, and sometimes compute clusters with thousands of GPUs. How to couple these models with the extreme constraints of devices that have a few kilobytes of onboard memory, up to maybe 1 MB if we are very lucky, limited computational performance, and that are typically very difficult to use in the sense that if you want to get fast, you have to extract performance out of very specialized and very hard to program hardware acceleration facilities. So, how can we bridge this divide? So, in our work, we proceeded from the bottom up and with a very simple divide et impera strategy. So we tried to split the problem in several pieces that can be tackled one at a time. So if we proceed, as I said, from the bottom up, the first step, the first reasonable step in our strategy could be efficiently exploiting the hardware strength. So being good at exploiting whatever performance that is guaranteed by the hardware architecture without caring about things such as moving data. So in our first step, we focus on maximizing the utilization of the available compute units, and we build libraries that are focused at DNN primitives, such as, for example, convolutional or fully connected layers, that are designed to achieve high performance and high energy efficiency on data that is stored directly inside the device and inside the memory of the device that is most convenient to us to extract performance. For example, think of an L1 cache. However, of course, data is not there from the start. So we have to couple the DNN primitives that we design with the knowledge that, in fact, we will have to deal with memories that are large, that are outside of the chip. And we need this because realistically sized DNNs require a minimum of a few megabytes of weights. So if we want to run a realistically sized deep neural network, we need to be able to schedule computation in such a way that we manipulate data with our primitives on the very small on-chip memories. At the same time, we minimize the off-chip access that we still need. We need the off-chip access, we minimize it, and we maximize the usage of the optimized primitives. So it's a very complicated problem. We have to keep together several constraints that are conflicting with one another. Moreover, in order to produce deep neural networks that are tuned to run on embedded low-performance hardware, another key step that is a bit higher level than what we discussed up to now is the usage of quantized data for weights and for activations of the deep neural networks. Quantization is advantageous for us for two reasons. First of all, it's clear it reduces the memory footprint. But second, at the same time, it also enables the usage of faster arithmetic primitives in the low layers of our deployment stack. So in fact, by using quantization, we enable also faster DNN primitives. So far, let's say at 8 bits have been selected as the industry standard to combine good accuracy with low footprint in terms of memory and high energy efficiency. And in fact, in this work, we focus on networks that are trained to use 8-bit integers as their main data type. Within the context of the PULP project, which I will describe a bit more in detail in the next slides, we have designed a fully open source and vertically integrated flow that puts together all of these steps, starting from quantization-aware training down to optimized execution on DNN optimized hardware. Out of not so abundant time in this presentation, I will focus mostly on the lowest layers of the development stack. These layers are PULP NN, our optimized library for neural networks that focuses on convolutional, fully connected, and so on. Primitives for these layers running in the lowest level of the memory hierarchy, and Dori, which is our tool for deployment oriented to memory. I will leave out whatever lives on top of these layers, such as Nemo, which is our tool for neural minimization for PyTorch. It's based on PyTorch. So let us start now by focusing on the architecture of a PULP system and on the optimized PULP NN libraries that we can run on top of it to optimize neural network execution. The open source PULP project is a tight cooperation between the University of Bologna in Italy and ETH Zurich in Switzerland. PULP focuses on the design of extreme edge devices, of research extreme edge devices, that are based on the concept of a parallel ultra low power cluster of RISC-V cores. Of course, given the topic of this talk, artificial intelligence and deep neural networks are one of the primary application targets of such a device. Specifically, in this talk, I'm going to focus on one commercial embodiment of PULP, which is GreenWave's GAP8. GAP8 is an advanced microcontroller that features autonomous I/O capability, has a 512 kilobyte on chip SRAM embedded inside the system on chip itself, and has support for external DRAM and flash memory connected through the Hyperbus interface. GAP8 employs as a main core of the microcontroller a RISC-V 32-bit in order core with four pipeline stages that is based on the RISC-V design from ETH Zurich developed within PULP. The main feature that distinguishes GAP8 from many other microcontrollers in the market is, of course, the fact that it is a parallel ultra-low power processor. What does it mean? It means that GAP8 embeds a powerful 8-core programmable accelerator. This programmable accelerator consists of a cluster of 8 RISC-V cores that are meant to accelerate parallel workloads, such as the linear algebra that is typical of deep neural networks. The cluster is centered around a small but extremely fast memory of 64 kilobytes that is connected with very high bandwidth and is shared by all cores. This memory is a scratch pad that is manually managed by means of a cluster DMA that moves data from the L1 memory to the level 2 SRAM, that is the rest of the system, and back. In order to fully exploit the K8 architecture, a deep neural network application must be able to mine all the performance from the cluster while using intelligently the scarce amount of on-chip memory and scheduling the data movement using the cluster DMA between L2 and L1 and using the microcontroller DMA from the L2 to the external level 3 DRAM. Moreover, it has to efficiently use the cores that are embedded in the cluster. These cores are special, in fact, they are not simple RISC-V cores, but they include XPulp extensions for digital signal processing, such as hardware loops, post-increment of addresses, and CMD instructions such as sum of dot products or accumulation of dot products on data that is 8 or 16 bits. Moreover, the cluster is highly tuned to fine-grained execution of parallel workloads by means of an hardware-accelerated synchronization mechanism, which allows to split parallel jobs at a very, very fine grain. So, how does our optimized library for deep neural network primitives work? Our library, which is called PulpNN, takes care of the task of executing convolutional, fully connected, etc. primitives fast without caring about how data is moved between level 2 and level 3 and level 1 and level 2 of the memory. So it assumes that all the data that we care about is resident inside the level 1 scratch pad. How is the computation organized? Of course, I cannot go in detail in a short talk, but this is to give you the idea. The target of PulpNN is to use execution targeted at integer of 8 bits and to maximize data reuse in the register file, improve the kernel regularity, and exploit the innermost parallelism of convolution and fully connected computation. In fact, it reorganizes all the convolution computation as a combination of matrix multiplications. Here we see on the left the innermost loop of the PulpNN library, which works similarly for all kinds of layers that are supported. In this innermost loop, each RISC-V core starts by exploiting load instruction with address post increment to fetch a total of 16 bytes of weights that are organized in a matrix of 4 output channels by 4 input channels and filter weights. After this, it continues by loading 8 bytes of pixels from 2 different rows in the input feature maps and across 4 input channels or filter weights. This makes a total of 6 loads per each iteration of the innermost loop. And with this, we have enough data to perform a total of 32 multiply accumulate operations that, thanks to the availability of dot product CMD instructions, is performed along 8 cycles. During these 8 cycles, a total of 32 8-bit multiply accumulate operations is performed, and the accumulations, the outputs are saved in a total of 8 accumulators organized in 4 channels across 2 spatial rows. Of course, it's matrix multiplication, it takes the sizes out of the inputs that are not destroyed by the matmul. These accumulators are of course kept along multiple iterations because these we need to continue the matmul by going over this direction and this direction of the inputs. To do so, we exploit the hardware loop mechanism, which has a very, very minimal overhead, and in fact allows to execute this loop almost as if it was fully unrolled. This loop is executed over the input channel and filter size dimensions, completing the execution over these. Finally, of course, we have multiple cores. How do we fill them? To fill the 8 cores that we have available in GAP8, we parallelize over the column dimension. So we compute with each core a different column of our output. Whereas using this strategy requires some initial data marshalling to reorganize inputs, in particular the activation inputs, it has a very regular and tight inner loop with only 6 loads and 8 MAC, let's say, dot product instructions to perform 32 MACs. And thanks to this, it can achieve on 8 cores up to 15.5 MACs per cycle, which, if you look, it's a pretty good utilization of the device. Of course, as we discussed, achieving such a high peak performance with data in L1 is not nearly enough to achieve high end-to-end performance. To this end, we designed Dory, which is a tool for deployment oriented to memory. In short, Dory is designed to divide the computation in tiles that fit on chip memory while organizing off-chip access in the most efficient way possible. To understand how tiling works, let's have a look at the architecture of a GAP8 system rotated by 90 degrees. The full representation of a realistically sized network, such as, for example, a mobile net, cannot really be stored in an on-chip memory. It always requires megabytes or tens or even hundreds of megabytes of four weights. So this kind of data has always to reside in the external DRAM or in the flash, more realistically. So what we have to do to actually use it and run it is to split it in smaller pieces. Tensor tiling means exactly this. It means that we copy inside the on-chip SRAM, in this case the 512 kilobyte L2, only a small block or tile of the input and tensor and weight data that we need. In the case of GAP8, with 512 kilobytes of space, we can often fit all weights for one layer. Sometimes we need to split the layer in two or three parts. But in general, at this level, we are good. We can execute a full layer. So a tile is equivalent to a given layer. However, if we go to the following level of the memory hierarchy, between L2 and L1, we have only 64 kilobytes of space. So if we want to bring data from L3 to L2 and from L2 to L1, we have to make it fit a much, much smaller amount of space. How is it possible to find tiles that make sense, minimize the transfer overhead, and at the same time are capable of exploiting the performance of pulp and end primitives? Well, the technique that we used in Dory is to abstract this general problem as a constraint programming problem using Google Earth tools to solve it. The starting point is the idea of maximizing the size of the three tiles that we need: inputs, weights, and output activations, subject, of course, to the total size of the memory that we have to fit. To this, we have to add a set of geometrical constraints, of course. The size of the tiles are like the size of the tensors, joined with one another. They are tied by one another, and we have to keep care that we use validly sized tiles. Moreover, if we want to be optimal in terms of speed, We also want to favor solutions which, for example, expose enough parallelism to keep all the cores busy. These kind of considerations, which are in fact many, we take into account by expanding the cost function using heuristic components. These help select automatically the tile combinations that will perform best on hardware. The solutions that we get can be used to generate automatically code that moves the data tiles between the various levels of the memory hierarchy. In fact, working like a software managed cache, automatic cache. These data transfers are organized in a fully triple buffered fashion so that in most cases, transfer overheads are hidden and do not hinder performance. And we can, in fact, organize our computation as a software pipeline. Overall, Dory generates from an integer network produced by higher level of the our deployment flow directly a set of network and layer level C source codes that can be directly compiled and run on a GAP8 platform. Here on the right, we see the example of a mobile net V1 run on 128 by 128 input. This achieves 59% top 1 accuracy on ImageNet, so it's not exceptional, but it's a realistic network. And we demonstrate that we can achieve real-time performance in under 25 millijoule per frame on top of this device, consuming only a few milliwatts. See what the peak power is here. If you're not convinced, I attached a small video that is designed, that is from people that used our full flow for a robotic application. The team that worked on this is the team of Alessandro Giusti at Izia Lugano. In this case, the Nano drone hosts a GAP8 processor and runs a neural network that tries to keep the position of the drone aligned with the front of a human's face. So, I'm finished. I guess your question now is, where can I get this fantastic full flow? Fortunately, our deployment flow is fully open source, as well as our full hardware platform. From our GitHub page, github.com/PalPlatform, you can get the PalPenN library, the Dory deployment tool, and also the NeMo network minimization tool that I just briefly mentioned at the beginning of the talk. With this, I thank you very much for your attention, and let me also thank the people who did all the hard work that I presented, in particular Angelo Garofalo and Alessio Burrello, who worked respectively on PalPenN and on Dory, and also all the rest of the awesome DNN on Palp team. Thank you very much for your attention, and have a good evening.